In today's video, we're talking about the 40K metagame, exactly what is meant by it, and how you can take advantage of it to win more games. Hello and welcome back to Auspex Tactics, the strategy-focused 40K channel, where we're all about getting the most out of our miniatures on the tabletop. When we're talking about the various armies and factions competing, the term meta gets bandied around quite a lot, so in this video I thought we'd just fully talk about what that means, what exactly a metagame is, how the meta tends to work in 40K, how understanding the meta can give you a bit of an edge in winning games, and also talking a bit about different factors that might affect a game's meta, including local areas and different missions and things. So in general, a metagame generally refers to the external factors that can influence a game that aren't really necessarily tied to actually the things within the game itself. Within the actual game of 40K, it tends to be two armies duking it out and using tactics to overcome each other. But there are quite a lot of external factors go into this, particularly picking lists and what you're likely to come up against, as well as technically all sorts of other things such as people's playstyles, and maybe factors including what models people can either afford or want to bother painting up. Generally, in Warhammer 40K, people tend to use the term the meta to refer to armies that are commonly played and the playstyles in which they're played. You frequently get the term meta armies used to talk about the strongest armies that are in the game at the moment and therefore are played more often. Rule shakeups happen quite frequently in Warhammer 40K, particularly now there are things such as chapter approved about. When points or rules change, there's generally a period of experimentation to establish what the best options are. I'd say that we're in that period at the moment. 9th edition has only just come out, and people are getting used to a whole load of new missions and things, and while it's obvious that some things are stronger than other things, I think what is truly the best of the best has yet to be established. Generally though, through feedback and looking at things like tournament results, people generally tend to figure out what are the strongest things to give them the most chance of winning, and those things will get played more and more by more people. At the moment, it does seem to be that Space Marines are in that top spot, and in more competitive games or events, I think that we'll see more people playing Space Marines. However, the fact that lots of people are playing Space Marines can mean that other armies have an option to counter them. Generally, when something becomes top dog, there are usually options for dealing with those units, such as, say, for example, taking a whole ton of high AP multi-damage weapons, which tend to do quite well against the Marines. It means that armies that can spam those could actually do quite well against Space Marines, and potentially even start winning a lot of games if they're pretty much tailoring to beat Marines down, and it means that they can go into those matchups with a bit of an advantage. That means that those armies will also become part of the meta as well, and it can mean that other armies that can counter them can become more appealing in turn. In general, things tend to settle down with a bit of a balanced equilibrium established, with a certain proportion of players playing each of the strongest decent factions, and barring some people who are trying to make some more quirky builds work, things tend to get a little bit stagnant and a bit more boring perhaps. Just as an example, we had a really good example of this in 8th edition, with Castellan Knights from Imperial Knights becoming pretty dominant. It wasn't immediately obvious from the drop of the codex, but people started to realise that with certain combinations, these really quite point-intensive knight castellans could actually get incredibly scary if you invested tons of stratagems in them. They could basically get up to a 3+ invul save, and they could have reroll ones of all of their shooting attacks, and it meant that they could easily clear out multiple hard targets from the enemy army per turn. They were just ridiculously efficient for anti-vehicle and anti-super heavy. This led to absolutely tons of people to start take Castellan knights to competitive tournaments, and they were so prevalent that it sort of became a bit pointless to be taking vehicle-centric armies, because if you ran into a knight castellan, you could have multiple vehicles removed in a single turn, and it was pretty much guaranteed to make the game a pretty uphill struggle. It made the meta really quite restrictive, because a lot of armies have powerful options and combos built with vehicles, and if none of them want to use them at all, then it means that there's a lot of playstyle restriction just because of the dominance of these knights. The other factions that tended to get played were things that could counter them quite well, such as either Eldar Inari or Crash World Flyers being able to use Doom and Jinx and potentially make the Castellan Knights killable in a single turn, so they didn't have to worry about it for the rest of the game. Another option was potentially to ignore it and just take a ridiculous amount of Playbearers from Chaos Demons and screen for a whole lot of Psykers or Thousand Suns characters casting Smite behind them. So basically you could just laugh off the Castellan's firepower and go about stealing all the objectives. Things got very stable for really quite a long time, until Games Workshop decided to do something about it, and they heavily nerfed the Castellan, so people didn't feel the need to take it all the time anymore. If you do have a pretty good understanding of what the current meta is, then it can give you an advantage. You should generally be building lists with both the mission and the meta in mind. As well as just taking the strongest stuff, you should also be thinking, how is this going to translate into doing well in the mission that I'm playing? And will it give me any sort of edge if I know the sort of things that other people are likely to be playing? For example, over the course of the last year, we had Iron Hands become incredibly dominant within the meta, with tons of people running vehicle-based armies for a while. To counter the meta, you could run Iron Hands yourself, and maybe just tailor the weapons that you're taking to be more anti-tank. You could take an army that's something that's in the meta at the moment just really struggles to kill, and play to win the mission, such as, for example, running that enormous horde of Plague Bearers against the Castellan meta. Sure, you won't ever kill the Knight Castellan, but you'll likely steal all the objectives all game long, so it might mean that you just win the game from that perspective anyway. You could take something that's incredibly good at killing the meta armies. Say, for example, when Space Marines got so popular, I saw some creative lists using Eldar and Expert Crafters to run absolutely tons of high-strength, high-AP shooting, such as Star Cannons and Bright Lances, and units like Shining Spears who can cut through things like Centurions or Aggressors pretty nicely in close combat. It might mean that you just have a bit more of a fighting chance against the top dog. You could also take choices that counter a certain playstyle, such as shutting down deep strikers with screening units, such as say if Genestealer Cults got really good, then units like Space Marine Infiltrators are basically the best counter to them, as it can basically be a way of eliminating their deep strike charge ability, which is very powerful. I bear in mind that the meta isn't just one thing. There is a bit of a national meta usually, with things that you're most likely to find going across the country. But in general, quite a lot of games are played at a smaller group with its own local meta, whether that's at a game store, a regular series of tournaments near you, or even if you only have a couple of regular opponents, and you're basically going to know what that meta is and what sort of things you're likely to face. For example, in a small group, if you had two players out of the three that you regularly play who take very tank-orientated lists, then the meta is basically going to be good for you to take anti-tank weapons. You can still take absolute tons of anti-infantry guns, but it's likely to be less strong than taking the anti-tank weapons if you know that most of your games you will be fighting loads of tanks. Different formats can also create their own meta as well, such as certain tournaments having slightly different rules on objective scoring, such as the ITC secondaries in 8th edition. It meant that if you were just playing Games Workshop's core missions, then certain units could be far more powerful than that compared with in ITC, where certain units that you could take could just be a bit of a liability, because it meant that the secondary objectives could be really easy to achieve against those certain targets. Different sizes of game might warp the meta a bit as well. In general, some armies will be better or worse at playing very small games. Some armies just need a fair bit of synergy to really function efficiently, such as having multiple stacking buff characters, which aren't very efficient at all if you're playing a very small game like Combat Patrol. Generally, the meta choices there are going to be getting as many wounds and as much damage output on the table for as cheap points as possible. You might even get different meta options when you're playing something like Tabletop Simulator, as that would remove the barrier of people actually having to buy and paint up models. It means that you could get some very, very weird lists being played altogether, such as spamming absolutely tons of one weird unit that most people in the real world wouldn't have bothered to build up so many copies of. So overall, I'd be aware of the meta and think about what sort of things you might likely face when going into games, as it is quite a big part of the skill of list building in Warhammer 40K. If you've got any other thoughts on the meta that I've missed, please let me know in the comments below. It'll be interesting to hear your thoughts. If you've enjoyed the video, feel free to subscribe to the channel for plenty of similar 40K content coming out very regularly. And if you are enjoying my content, then I'd just like to mention that the channel has a Patreon page, which you can find down in the video description below. The support of the generous people on Patreon is what allows me to keep on making these videos quite so regularly, so if you are watching a lot, any support is greatly appreciated. Channel Patrons get to see one video early each week, there's regular polls to see what sort of things happen next on the channel, and you also get automatically entered into the Auspex Tactics prize draw each month, with the chance to win some big kits. If any of that sounds interesting, or you'd just like to help, then you can find the link to the page down in the video description below. In any case, a massive thank you for listening, and I'll hope to see you guys next time.